Second, the final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 3777 in the name of Bob Doris on MND Scotland report No Time to Lose, addressing the housing needs of people with MND. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members who wish to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Bob Doris to open the debate for around 7 minutes, Mr. Doris.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And today is Global MND Awareness Day. People affected by motor neuron disease all over the world will remember those they have loved and lost to this devastating terminal disease. Here in the Scottish Parliament, as a community, we will be no different. There will be friends and loved ones no longer with us. And during the course of this evening's debate, we'll no doubt hear about some of those people. And for some colleagues in this chamber, that will also include Gordon Aikman, whose loss is still very felt in this place. This evening's debate is focused on housing and how we better support those with us today living with MND. On that front, I am sure we will agree there remains much still needing to be done. I would like to thank the many MSPs who have signed my parliamentary motion to allow me to secure this debate this evening on addressing the housing needs of people with motor neuron disease. And I also wish to thank MND Scotland for their powerful, very sobering and challenging report, No Time to Lose, which gathers much of the vital data and importantly captures the crucial lived experience and reality of individuals living with MND and their families. My thanks to the families who have shared their stories, including Marie, whose husband Ian had MND, Beverly, whose husband Alan had MND, and Lynn, whose father-in-law Drew had MND. They played pivotal roles in this research and in the public gallery here this evening, and I thank them for their attendance and for their contribution. That is exactly where this debate must begin. I want to quote two lived experiences direct from the report. The first one I raised at First Minister's questions a few months ago. Marie, who I mentioned earlier, told MND Scotland, "My husband lived in the living room with no shower facilities at all. We were washing him out on the decking with buckets of water. No dignity in that whatsoever." 11% of people affected by MND reported waiting more than a year for a wet room. For some, the wait is longer than the time they have left. We should just let that sink in. We must do better. Of the local authorities who responded to MND Scotland, the average waiting time for wet rooms to be fitted in 2020-2021 was 158 days. However, one local authority reported an 80.7-day average waiting time, and another it was 256 days. That's 3 months compared to 8.5 months. Every local authority must strive to do better, but the regional variations demonstrate that improvements can surely be made by learning from best practice. On requiring a ramp, a family member of another MND sufferer said, "We got in touch to apply for a ramp, and we were asked by the local council if he could still walk. He said yes, and so they said, 'We'll not look at it until you can't walk.' He asked how long the waiting list was, and it was 9 months. So they wanted us to wait 9 months from the point that he couldn't get out. There has to be a better way to deal with adaptations like this. It needs to be proactive, not reactive or heavily delayed. People cannot be prisoners in their own homes. For ramps, there's an average waiting time of 149 days. However, one local authority said that they had an average waiting time of just 23 days. With another local authority had an average waiting time of 475 days. Again, the regional variations are stark. It cannot be right to have a wait of 15 and a half months to have a ramp installed when the average prognosis for someone living with MND following diagnosis is just 18 months. There are various recommendations in the MND Scotland report regarding adaptations. Understandably, MND Scotland have called on the Scottish Government to require local authorities to formally fast-track applications for adaptations for people with MND, and they have suggested that certain social security forms could be used to underpin such a scheme. That's a powerful call, Presiding Officer. Of course, there may be resource implications, and increased investment and resource may be required. I don't doubt the challenge in identifying and securing that resource. We shouldn't pretend otherwise. However, with a cross-party purpose, I very much hope we can find a way forward. And we also need to ensure that even if a property is not externally accessible, That cannot be used as a justification not to adapt the property internally. MND Scotland have reported that that happens far too often. It's hardly surprising that MND Scotland have called the report No Time to Lose. Anything we can do in this place to allow as much of the precious time that those living with MND have left to make invaluable memories with loved ones, rather than having a prolonged fight to have their housing needs met, we must do it. The properties we build today must be future-proof to be fit for the purpose in years to come. As our life circumstances change, including our health, increasingly we must have housing stock which is both accessible and easily adaptable. This should be dealt with at the design and build stage, Presiding Officer. Looking for imperfect housing solutions to support accessibility both internally and externally, which can be difficult to resolve, must increasingly become a thing of the past. So must having to move properties in the first place. I know that is something Glasgow City Council have been keen to see, having championed the Glasgow standard for developments attracting public subsidy and also seeking to ensure 10% of new properties being wheelchair accessible across all tenures. I should note, though, Presiding Officer, I couldn't get data in relation to waiting times in Glasgow, and I look to meet with them soon to work how we can work in partnership with them and housing associations to get that data and to drive improvements there as well. I also acknowledge the work of the Scottish Government in this area, with around £16 billion being invested by the Scottish Government to deliver 100,000 additional affordable homes by 2032. With a minimum of 70% of these being for social rent, there is a real opportunity to make sure that we future-proof all new properties for families across all tenures. I know this is something the Scottish Government is keen to see happen as it develops a common housing standard as part of its work on housing to 2040. In the meantime, however, there remains significant issues over agreed definitions of what constitutes an accessible home in the first place. And in various other matters, more must be done. Likewise, much more needs to be done to ensure better alignment between the various allocation policies of councils and the various housing associations. And we need to ensure they are more consistently taken into account of the housing needs of those living with MND within those allocation policies. For my part, as I have said, I will be arranging to meet with colleagues at Glasgow City Council to see what more they can do in partnership with housing providers to better meet the housing needs of those living with MND. I know the First Minister pledged the Scottish Government would take the time to consider the various recommendations contained within the MND Scotland report No Time to Lose. I look forward to hearing the thoughts of colleagues this evening on this, as well as an update from the Cabinet Secretary on how the issues contained within this report are being addressed. In particular, we need robust, reliable, comparable and routinely collected data on the wait for adaptations across all 32 local authorities. We need to see the waiting times reduce and the significant gaps in performance across local authorities narrow. That needs to include fast-tracking as required also. We need similar meaningful comparisons in how local authorities and housing associations use their allocation policies to support the housing needs of those living with MND. And we need to build homes fit for the future. I know there is much good work ongoing, but I'm conscious the title of the report is No Time to Wait, Presiding Officer. In conclusion, for some of the people in the gallery here today, time ran out for them and their loved ones, but together, across party and across Parliament, we must do better. And I thank you for taking the time to listen to my contribution here this evening.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Doris. I now call Graeme Simpson, who will be followed by Mark Griffin for around 4 minutes. Mr. Simpson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I start by congratulating Bob Doris for securing this very important debate and indeed for his speech, which was very, very considered. And I know he feels strongly about the issues. I also want to thank MND Scotland for giving a presentation to the cross-party group on housing, which I'm lucky enough to convene, about this report, No Time to Lose. And it was a very powerful presentation indeed. And I welcome MND Scotland and their guests to the public gallery as well. Now, as Bob Doris has said, today is Global MND Awareness Day. Well, actually, every day should be MND Awareness Day, because we should be alert to the issues all the time, full stop, and be doing something about it. We shouldn't need a special badge to do that. The report raises a number of issues, and there are some stark statistics in it. There's a 1 in 300 risk of getting MND in your lifetime. That sounds quite high to me. As Bob Doris has said, the average life expectancy after diagnosis is just 18 months. So that's a really short period of time, and that tells you that when you are diagnosed, you need fast action. In too many parts of Scotland, we're not getting that. So in the report, No Time to Lose, which was carried out in 2021, a number of points were made. There are extensive waiting times for adaptations. Ramp waiting times are particularly lengthy. The wait across local authorities was on average 149 days to get something done to your property. One council reported an average wait of 256 days to fit a wet room, which is vital. 11% of people with MND waited for a year for a wet room. People with MND faced barriers to accessing adaptations. Now, I want to, as I come to a close, just mention something in my own patch, some figures from North and South Lanarkshire. And before I do, I watch with interest. Bob Doris mentioned Marie, that's Marie Cartwright, and she featured on the BBC, actually talking about her own situation with her husband Ian, and she, I remember she stood outside her house and she was sort of demonstrating how she had to throw buckets of water over Ian to wash him outside, which is quite heartbreaking when you think of it, that someone has to do that. So when North and South Lanarkshire were asked, what is your definition of accessible housing? North Lanarkshire do not reference external documentation. South Lanarkshire referred to housing for varying needs. What percentage of your local authority or social housing stock is accessible or wheelchair accessible? North Lanarkshire says wheelchair livable properties, 0.45% only of council stock, and 0.34% of all social housing stock. Not really good enough. South Lanarkshire, 0.8% wheelchair accessible housing, and that includes sheltered housing. Really, really poor figures. I could go on because I'm well aware I'm over time, but the figures across both councils in my patch are really not good enough. The postcode lottery has to end. I think government and councils have to work together to address this problem so that we do not have to put up with this any longer. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Simpson. I now call on Mark Griffin, who joins us remotely, who will be followed by Eleanor Whittam for around 4 minutes. Mr. Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful to speak in today's debate on Global MND Awareness Day. The work of MND Scotland in driving the issue of the availability of accessible housing up the agenda is fantastic. And their report, No Time to Lose, has been vital in understanding the changes that are needed to secure accessible housing and adaptations that fit for purpose, ahead of the promised review of the Housing for Various Varying Needs Design Guide. And thank you also to Bob Doris for getting the debate to the Chamber today so that we can all talk about it this evening. It's utterly disheartening, though, that the report's recommendations are not already a reality. The postcode lottery of support people with MND are struggling with, just to get the housing that works for them while battling a rapidly progressing neurological illness, summing their final months, is nothing short of cruelty. And I hope when the Cabinet Secretary speaks, you can confirm the government is working across government and with partners to pursue these badly needed changes. The fast track applications have a common and consistent definition of accessible housing, a 10% target for wheelchair accessible new build homes, and real increased resources for adaptations across Scotland. Because, Presiding Officer, the research that MND Scotland conducted for this report is so valuable to understand the task, then I don't think the government's own statistics are up to the job. Like the patchwork of policies, the data is inconsistent and in itself requires a real overhaul if central government wants to truly make our housing system accessible. Now, in my own region in central Scotland, MND Scotland found that in Falkirk, just 1% of stock is wheelchair accessible. There is only an aspiration to build accessible properties in new builds, but no target for people who are terminally ill, for people terminally ill are not prioritised. And the average wait in 2020-21 was 675 days, almost 2 years. Graeme Simpson previously cited the situation in North and South Lanarkshire, and while it only takes 272 days for a disabled person to be housed in North Lanarkshire, last year it took 2.25 years in South Lanarkshire. And I think those are devastating figures for disabled people and people with MND. Some waiting over 18 months from a diagnosis underline just how important today's debate is. As a party, Scottish Labour have gone into the last two elections committing to a 10% target for new homes to be wheelchair accessible. And I welcomed the government's commitment last week to deliver a target for all tenures. But I would be interested to hear if there have been any discussions across government, particularly with the planning minister, so that we could secure that target in the upcoming MPF4, which is making its way through Parliament at the moment, and looking specifically at making a requirement in the Affordable Housing Supply Programme. There are amazing contributions being made by some RSLs and councils up and down the country to build more accessible homes, but it does need national coordination, and doing it through the Affordable Housing Supply Programme would be one way to do it. And the idea of fast track allocations and adaptations is an excellent one, and it's commendable of MND Scotland to pursue that. And building on the successes of MND Scotland during the passage of the Social Security Act in 2018 to get fast-tracked benefits for those terminally ill, I'm pleased to see that the charity now pushing this concept further. It's an absolute necessity for fast-progressing MND and is an area where national and local government can make strides in providing a real impact in supporting people, because I think we can all agree that the last thing someone who is terminally ill needs to be doing is battling with public sector bureaucracy. But, Presiding Officer, the work done by MND Scotland and the recommendations we've been able to debate today will undoubtedly have benefits for all disabled people in Scotland, especially those requiring wheelchair-accessible housing. And I hope the government can undertake to make sure more support comes in time for people with MND in Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Griffin. I now call on Eleanor Whittam to be followed by Gillian Mackay for around 4 minutes. Ms Whittam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First, may I thank my colleague Bob Doris for securing this important debate. I recently had a meeting with MND Scotland to discuss their report No Time to Lose, which addresses the housing needs of people with motor neuron disease, and to hear of the lived experience of my constituent, Lynn McCartney, who is the surviving daughter-in-law of MND sufferer Drew McCartney. And I welcome Lynn to the public gallery today. At this meeting, I heard of how too many people with MND cannot get adaptations or an accessible home quickly enough because systems are not designed for people living with a rapidly progressive terminal illness, and that some local authorities' waiting lists for adaptations and accessible housing are longer than the average life expectancy for somebody with MND, which we've already heard is approximately 18 months from diagnosis. And as a consequence of this, people with the illness can be trapped in unsafe homes, sometimes in a single room, living without the dignity and care that every person is entitled to. I heard firsthand from Lynn about the challenges she and her family faced when trying to secure suitable accommodation for her father-in-law, Drew, when their own home was deemed unsafe, and of the immense anxiety and stress this caused the family during the precious time they had after Drew's MND diagnosis, which was regrettably an all too familiar experience. The McCartneys resorted to residing in their towing holiday caravan without central heating or running hot water, out with their local authority area and support network for nearly a year. And some of you may remember this was on the news. In order to provide the most accessible accommodation as quickly as they could, once it became apparent that with many external and internal stairs, their own home was no longer safe. Drew and his wife Helen were eventually rehoused in a lovely accessible bungalow back in Cumnock, near family, where he was able to live his remaining life to the full, surrounded by friends and family. His daughter-in-law Lynn was at pains to explain to me that Drew got many more months than the average MND patient, and had that not happened, he could have well have passed away whilst living in that caravan. I cannot escape the valid points that my constituent in MND Scotland make with regards to the housing struggles people who receive an MND diagnosis face, and I'm particularly struck by the desperately short life expectancy of 18 months from diagnosis. I raised this family's plight to the Cabinet Secretary's attention, and she advised me that the Housing to 2040 strategy sets out our vision for housing in Scotland, and we have a roadmap set out to help us achieve this. And the aim is to ensure that everyone has a safe, good quality and affordable home that meets their needs in a place that they want to be. This includes all aspects of housing and independent living for disabled people. I'm glad to note that actions being progressed include improvements to streamline and accelerate the adaptation system, and that part of this work, the adaptations process will be made simpler and quicker, including options for fast-tracking those with MND and other life-limiting illnesses. There will also be a focus on promoting awareness of and greater use of the scheme of assistance to fund adaptations and consideration of passporting good practice and allocations processes that offer options to directly match people with MND and other life-limiting illnesses to suitable accommodation. And additionally, this review work will also consider the requirement for a consistent, nationally agreed definition of what an accessible home is and progress in delivering wheelchair housing targets. Now, we've heard across the chamber that this is a postcode lottery at the moment, and we really do need to have an agreed definition. And I'm also pleased, as Mark Griffin has pointed out, that our new adult disability payment from Social Security Scotland will ensure that those facing this illness will be financially supported in a respectful and dignified way. I've also been engaging with the newly appointed Head of Housing and Communities at East Ayrshire Council, who has agreed to work closely with MND Scotland to ensure that their next housing needs and demand assessment, which informs their local housing strategy, has MND fully in mind. Those living with MND have no time to lose, and it is incumbent upon us in this place and across our council chambers to find solutions that will enable them to spend what time they have left pursuing what makes them happiest with those they love the most. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Whittam. I now call on Gillian Mackay, who joins us remotely. Ms. Mackay, for around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I too would like to thank Bob Dorris for bringing this debate to the Chamber. I spoke in his members' debate on the last MND Awareness Day, and I recognise Mr Dorris's efforts to raise awareness of this condition. As others have said, MND is a rapidly progressing condition, and average life expectancy is just 18 months from diagnosis. Diagnosis of MND can be devastating for people and their families who have to come to terms with the fact that their loved one may lose the ability to walk, talk, eat, drink or breathe unaided, sometimes in a very short time frame. According to MND Scotland, most people with MND will need adaptions to their homes such as handrails, ramps or wet rooms. If these adaptions cannot be made, they may need to move into another, more accessible home. However, as we've heard, there are major issues around availability of accessible housing. According to Inclusion Scotland, many disabled people in Scotland do not live in a home that meets their needs, and 86,000 households in Scotland that include a disabled person need an adaption but do not have one. Waiting lists can often be longer than life expectancy for people with MND, which means that people are spending the time they have left with their family and friends fighting for accessible housing which meets their needs, with some unfortunately dying before they get it. In the report No Time to Lose, MND Scotland emphasised the importance of early intervention. Too often local authorities are fitting adaptions reactively. People are being asked not to apply until they need them and then are faced with long waiting lists. The report highlights that adaptions we know someone with MND will need, such as wet rooms, ramps or handrails, should form part of forward planning from the point of diagnosis. But while there is evidence of good practice across some local authorities, the current postcode lottery means that some people are being told they are asking for adaptions too soon. Given the rapidly progressive nature of MND, there should be no such thing as too soon. And MND Scotland is calling for improved understanding of the condition amongst people working in local authorities. Poor understanding can mean people with MND miss out on support they are entitled to, and can be traumatised by having to explain their condition over and over again to multiple key workers. When good practice is taking place, it's often because an individual practitioner, such as an occupational therapist, has a good understanding of the condition and how it progresses, and has pushed for adaptions to be installed more quickly. I want to highlight that the report did find that some key workers, such as occupational therapists, were doing great work in this regard and acting as excellent advocates for their patients. Increased awareness and understanding of MND will mean more people will receive this level of support. As I've said, where adaptions cannot be made, people with MND may have to move to other accommodation. Leaving your home can be a very stressful, emotional time, and we need to support people through this process where it is necessary. However, the report highlights that applying for an accessible home is often an arduous, time-consuming process. To quote the report, people are left spending time and energy fighting for homes that meet their accessibility needs and requirements. For many bereaved family members and carers, this meant there was less time spent with the person diagnosed. Instead, navigating forms and arguing for needs took up time that they did not have, took time away from doing things together and making memories. The support for people with MND who are applying for adaptions or new accommodation must be greatly improved. Processes should be streamlined where possible, and people with MND and their families should be supported by well-informed key workers who appreciate the rapidly progressing nature of the condition. This will help people to spend time that they have left with their loved ones, not fighting for housing that meets their needs.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Mackay. I now invite Shona Robison to respond to the debate. Cabinet Secretary, for around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much. And can I welcome Global MND Awareness Day and to thank Bob Doris for bringing this important debate here today. And I'm really pleased to be able to respond on behalf of the government and try to address as many points as I can. I think this Parliament has a proud record of raising issues around MND and more importantly, making progress on them. And of course, Gordon Aitken was a pivotal figure in doing that. And Bob Doris was quite right to pay tribute to his work. The important contributions that we've heard today have all raised awareness of MND. And we've also heard about the work that MND Scotland, and particularly their report No Time to Lose, addressing the housing needs of people with MND. And a very significant report indeed, and members have highlighted the housing needs and aspirations of those diagnosed alongside their families and carers. We want everyone with a life-limiting condition such as MND to be given the support they need to live at home or in a property that meets their needs. Now, I recently met with Rachel Maitland, the Chief Executive Officer of MND, and her team to discuss the recommendations of the report. And it was a very helpful meeting, certainly from my perspective and hopefully from theirs as well. And I got some very useful feedback about some of the good practice around, for example, speedy access to adaptations and the practical approaches to finding suitable accessible homes for people with MND. And I think what's important is that we replicate that good practice. So I plan to discuss this with COSLA, with the new COSLA team, to ensure that we continue to support the spread of good practice across Scotland. And I'm very clear we need to make improvements. I've heard a number of members this evening make those points. I'm aware of the complex cases also where people with profound mobility issues of whatever nature have struggled to find suitable, accessible, affordable housing. Now, there are lessons to be learned from these experiences so that our homes can fully support our changing needs and expectations. Yes.
Graeme Simpson.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking the intervention? She said she'll be in discussions with COSLA, which is entirely right, because most of the recommendations in the report relate to councils, it seems to me. But there are some that are aimed at government, one of which is that the Scottish Government should establish a common and consistent definition of accessible housing. There are others. So can she say which of the recommendations she will be able to take forward?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, I can. Many of these are already being worked on, and I'm happy to provide updates to this. And of course, I'll come on to one or two of these in a second. Just firstly, though, on the point of being able to live independently, it's what we would want for ourselves and our loved ones, and living independently helps ease the pressure on services as well as family members. So to support this, our homes should be accessible, flexible and importantly easily adapted to suit changing needs. So in terms of what we're doing, we have of course set the strategy Housing to 2040, which sets out our long-term vision for housing, which includes the delivery of homes built to housing for varying needs. And that guidance remains central to our affordable housing supply programme, and we're reviewing the guidance to ensure that it continues to be ambitious and meet the needs it needs to meet. And that will help to inform a new 10-year neutral housing standard for Scotland, which was included in Housing to 2040. Initial engagement with stakeholders is already underway, and we aim to produce a draft standard next year and to progress legislation after that. As you know, local... Yes.
Bob Doris.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. Really good work taking place, but I know this can be prolonged when there's consultations, drafts, legislation before things become statutory. Would you be working in partnership with all housing providers in the construction sector and planning authorities so that these draft standards, even though they may alter, we should be aiming to implement them at the earliest stage, even before they become statutory?
Cabinet Secretary, and give you the time back.
Yeah, yes, I'm happy to do that. And I think the point made by Mark Griffin about using all of the levers like NPF4, for example, in terms of new housing developments that are coming forward. And, of course, the importance of the Affordable Housing Supply Programme. I'll come back to that in a second. So local authorities, as people have recognised, are responsible for assessing the housing needs in their area, quite rightly, because they know their local areas, and importantly setting out in their local housing strategies how this will be met. Now, our guidance for councils to assist them with preparing those strategies ensures specialist and accessible homes are central to their housing planning and delivery process locally. So informed through the joint working with partners, including MND Scotland, we've put in place requirements for local authorities to set targets for the delivery of wheelchair-accessible homes across all tenures. So I guess that's a case of us leading from a centre, but working with local authorities to make those changes. And I'm pleased to say that 28 of the 32 local authorities have identified wheelchair-accessible targets, and the remaining four are in the process of finalising targets. And I think that's important. And increasing the supply will support more choice and flexibility for people, and, of course, it's fairer as well. Now, backing that up in terms of the Affordable Housing Supply Programme is, of course, the £3.6 billion that is being made available for this parliamentary session. Housing providers have had those five-year allocations, so they know what they have. What we need to make sure is that the range of homes that are built through that investment are able to meet everybody's needs. So we need the plans locally, we need the targets to be set based on local need, and then importantly, most importantly, we need those targets to be met. However, we know though that the majority of people in Scotland don't live in social housing, so although we're making progress with the Affordable Housing Supply Programme, we need to make sure that everyone, regardless of tenure, has a home that meets their needs now and into the future. And we know there are issues with the way adaptations are being accessed and delivered locally, and we are considering how the process can be streamlined and made easier for people who need adaptations when they ask, not months later. And that's really important in terms of the fast tracking for people who, where time is literally of the essence, and there's no time to wait for months for these adaptations to be done. So we understand that, and we need to make sure that action is taken to address that. We also know that technology is now playing an increasingly important role in supporting people's independent living, and the ability to remotely control household actions through the touch of a button can make life so much easier. So we want to ensure that advances in technology and the responses to the recent consultation on community equipment and housing adaptations, the draft guidance, inform our work to improve the adaptations system. Meantime, through our Housing Strategic Partners grant, we provide funding to organisations such as Housing Options Scotland and Care and Repair Scotland to provide specialist advice to people with disabilities to help them find the right house or make relevant adaptations so they can live in a home that meets their needs. And I would encourage people to use these sources of advice because they are really, really good. We know that the best way to resolve the disconnect between adaptations and timing is to ensure that housing, health and social care services are working together to streamline and accelerate the adaptation system. And embedding the person at the centre of that is essential, and that will be essential for the new National Care Service as it goes forward. And obviously significant steps on the creation of the National Care Service have been taken this week, and we need to get that right to address many of the issues. And I can tell you that Kevin Stewart, as the Minister responsible, is very acutely aware of this need.
You need to wind up,
yes,
please.
I just want to close the debate by thanking those who have contributed all of the examples, and to assure you that the Scottish Government will give full consideration to the report's recommendations to improve the housing outcomes for those living with MND. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.